my heart, oh God. Sinking in the truth. Sink my heart, oh God. May I be like you. You are the
God. Every month we have Juan and Nellie that they usually take a Sunday off, so this was one of those. They're up in San Francisco. Chales. Praise God. Let's open up with a word of prayer, and thank you everybody for being here today. We welcome you. And so, Father, we give you all the praise, we give you all the glory, we give you all the honor, and we thank you today. In Jesus' mighty name. And everybody said amen. God bless you. Today, we want to, I didn't really advertise this or didn't really say much about it, but today, I wanted to do a little service, a time of remembering, a time of mourning. You know, especially in the light of this crazy, tragic shooting that took place at a school. I think it was Tuesday, wasn't it? Tuesday? But I don't know. You know, sometimes as Christians, I'm going to say it like this. I think sometimes as Christians, we're so insensitive. I'm on social media, a lot, but not a whole lot, if that makes sense. And sometimes it seems like you can't ever say the right thing, right? When somebody dies and somebody loses someone, it's hard to say, and what do you say, right? As a pastor that I've done a lot of funeral services, you gotta understand this, since 1980. And one of the first funeral service, that I did in 1980 as brand new pastor, started pastoring in July 15th, 1980 in San Francisco. And I don't know how they got a hold of me, but they found me. And they asked me if I would come and do a service. And it was actually a service for a little newborn baby. You got to remember, I'm brand new, I'm nervous, I don't know what I'm going to say. I'm living in San Francisco, but I was asked to go to Oakland to do the service. And when I went up to Oakland, to my surprise, the limousine that pulled up is one of those, you got to remember, it's the 80s. And one of those stretched out a little bit. But they open the trunk and they pull out a little box. And, you know, you got to remember, I had never done a funeral prior to that. I had never seen anything like that prior to that. And, you know, I remember thinking to myself, saying to myself, man, what do you say and what do you do and all of this, right? Anyways, just the reason that I'm referencing that is because is that no matter what you say or what you express and all that, you always try to express comfort as much as possible. I know there's a scripture that says that we pray that we're able, may God enable us to be able to comfort others with the same comfort that we receive from the Lord. That's our hope, is to some way, somehow, is to be able to take whatever comfort, whatever things that we've been through in our life, is to be able to take that and be able to somehow comfort others along that line, along that capacity. Amen? So the reason I said that is because, you know, as I was reading something online, someone said, no, don't mourn. In other words, it's pretty much like saying, like, stop crying. You know, believe God, you know, don't cry, don't mourn, because Jesus rose from the dead. man, I don't know how you receive that. How do you receive that, right? And now the reason that I'm going there with this is because tomorrow is Memorial Day. And what that means is, because I know that a lot of people don't understand, it's not Veterans Day. How many know that there's a difference between Veterans Day and Memorial Day? See, because the Marines straightened me out on that. From doing the veteran services for the last 12 years or I don't know how many years I've been a part of the veterans parade that happens on Laurel Canyon. For years, I've been at the party corner. Was I a veteran? Nope. But I've been committed there for years because I was asked if I would help. And I don't have a no switch. I need to develop one. Certain things. But here's the point is this, that Memorial Day really is about remembering those whose lives or who gave their lives or whose lives while in service died serving our country. Right? Amen? Veterans Day, and I've had people say, it doesn't matter. Yes, it does. It does if you talk to military people because they understand it. Veterans Day is just where we remember every veteran that has ever been in the service. Today marks 50 years since my dad passed away on Memorial Day in 1972. He was a veteran who happened to pass away 50 years ago today, on Memorial Day. Some of you may have seen us, our picture or our story on the news. We were on the newspaper back in May. I think it came out by the 31st of 1972, where it just simply reads, veteran, denied bed, veteran, father of, I think they said 7 or 8, denied bed at the Veterans Hospital, right after the Veterans Hospital went down in Sylmar. My dad would have to go to the newer one, and I know a lot of you already heard this story, but that's the way they did it, and there it was so full and all this stuff, they literally told him, we can't take him unless he's dying. My mom took him home, brought him home. The next morning, we woke up to my mom screaming, only to find our father deceased after being denied a bed. So that's why it was all over the news. But tomorrow, by the way, if you want to go there, tomorrow I'll be over on Foothill and Taylor, I think it is, where that cemetery is there. They asked me if I would come and be there to pray and just remember. See, some of you don't even know there's a cemetery there, right? Right on the corner there. Foothill, go past Hubbard, go up a little bit past 7-Eleven, and you're going to see it on the left-hand side. There's a cemetery. So check it out later when you get a chance. That's what I mean. The idea is not to forget those that passed away and those that served in the armed forces. So tomorrow, that's we'll be there if you want to pop in at 11 a.m. Now, the reason I'm saying all that is because, you know, that today as we come together this morning, I really had been holding back about making any statements about the shooting. And then that was Monday or Tuesday. And then a few days later, we had a killing here in San Fernando, for those of you who didn't know about it. And I happened to talk to the chief, San Fernando chief of police, about it. But I said all that because what a crazy, crazy week this has been. The Gospels are not only the Gospels, but you know that the Gospels actually gives us a time where Jesus actually took some time to weep. Hello. He really did. That's why it's hard for me to connect with Christians when they live in this superficial bubble of no feeling, no compassion, lacking understanding, and not being able to at least take and pass some of that love, compassion, understanding, while trying to comfort people, right? John 11:32-37, it says that now when Mary came to where Jesus was and saw him, it says that she fell at his feet. You know, this is so powerful because it really is expression, not only because it's Jesus, but really because she's so broken over the death of her brother. You know, I don't know that there's been times where, you know, like I said, You know, I started in 1980, you know, doing services, and I've been through a lot of services. I've been a part of, for some of you, your family members that have lost loved ones. But boy, one of the things that I want to say is that there hasn't been a time that I've been involved in a service where I really have felt it and felt the hurt and all this. And I may not have been so close to them and all that, but I could feel and sense the pain, the brokenness, and just, and within, I don't know why, but it's just something that I, you know, not to say I understand, not to say that I know what you're going through, I can't say that, but I sense, I feel. And with that said, I also feel that brokenness within that. And all I can do is just weep with them, mourn with them, because that's really, if we have compassion, that's really what we should be doing. Come on, somebody. Amen. But listen to this. So it says, and I'm reading from John 11, 32 through 37, the ESV translation of the Bible. And then we're going to do some things here today, pray and remember the 19 kids and the two teachers who lost their life, tragically taken. When Jesus, and now when Mary came, and I'm at verse 32, when she came to where Jesus was and saw him, she fell at his feet. Right there, we need to make a connection. You know, sometimes, oh, she was worshiping Jesus. She was tambourine y todo, you know. No, that's not the ambience. That's not what's happening here. She's broken. She's ruined. She's shattered. And she throws herself at the feet of Jesus. Sounds what should be happening. In the Middle East, they mourn way, I don't know, they just have a way, because I remember the first time that I seen that, a mourning in the Middle East, the first time I seen it was, man, they literally would throw themselves on casket and just boom, all that. In our culture, in our world, in ours, it's more like we hold on. We're hello. not all of us. Because, you know, I've been around Blinky, right? Your primo, Charles. Where I was there, you know, as he's... I've seen, you know, when he had to bury his son. And I was there when he also buried his wife. And if there's anybody that maybe expresses and boom, just, you know, a lot of us are more reserved, right? We just, yeah, there's something about it. But this story here, and what we see is not just a story. What we see happening here is, as soon as she sees Jesus, no words, not yet. She's going to say some things, but the very first thing she does as a way of mourning, of grieving, of expression, of releasing this emotional buildup is by throwing herself at his feet. You know, I think if we could just take that emotion and somehow begin to express it in life, throughout life, imagine what that would be like if everybody that, you know, people that you loved and cared about, that you just living life, the moment, now, and expressing things we need to learn, right? So, but and then it transitions into not only just emotional total abandonment of brokenness and throwing herself at his feet, and then moves into, if you had, Lord, if you had been here, my brother would not have died. You know, it's okay to express that to the Lord. It's okay to be angry. It's okay to even come at the Lord and you know, and express with all respect, all that. But it's okay to say, Lord, if you would have just been here, then my brother would have never died. Earlier I said to you that some Christians are so disconnected and living in this plastic bubble that they would have said, don't question the Lord like that. Why can you talk like that to Jesus? Because I'm human. That's why. Because I have feelings. Because God made us emotional creatures. And it's okay. If he wanted you to be a robot, then he would have rewired you without emotional expressions. Right? Praise the Lord. Hallelujah. Well, I'm just saying, he pushed the button, praise the Lord. Boing, hallelujah. No. He did it where it's with our heart, our spirit, our emotions, our what he made us to be, who he made us to be, the total package. And I think that this scripture really shows us that in the very act, as we're looking at it, as she's throwing herself at his feet, and as she's laid out there, and then the expressions of, Lord, if you had been here, my brother would not have died. Look at verse 33. Just so you know, Jesus sees our weepings. He sees our mournings. Mournings. Right? And look at verse 33. When Jesus saw her weeping, and the Jews who had come with her also weeping, he was deeply moved in his spirit and greatly troubled. He's deeply moved with his spirit and greatly troubled. Now, I don't think that it is troubled in the sense like, what's wrong with you? You know, stop crying. It was more of an expression like, Lord, if you could take the life, the promise, the what I see in eternity and who you are and what you do and what you're capable, Lord, if you could take that and transmit and put it on them in the midst of their, and not to dismiss the human expression, but Lord, if you could just take and put the spirit and what you represent and what you're doing and what the totality, the understanding of serving the Lord. And that's why it's crazy, because when you think of a man by the name of Stephen, who was stoned to death, literally killed on the streets, that as they're killing him, he's getting a vision of heaven in the midst of rocks hitting him in the head and all this going on. In the midst of that, he sees Jesus. And in the midst of that, through this vision, seeing this totality of what Jesus represents and this whole God idea, in the midst of that, he's saying to him, Lord, don't hold it against them. Forgive them. Man, I got a long ways to go. How about you? I would have been, man, Lord, let me sock him on the way out. Let me drop kick. Hey, okay, I'm sorry, I'm human. But I'm just saying that that's how we feel. But listen to this. So Jesus is deeply moved, and then he's greatly troubled. So it's not, I don't think it's more like he's mad at them because what's wrong with you? I think it's more like, man, boy, Lord, open our eyes. Let us see. Let us behold. And says in verse 34, and he said, where have you laid him? And they said, Lord, come and see. Verse 35, Jesus joined in the weeping. Jesus felt it. Jesus was deeply moved by it. That's why, like, even in the midst of this tragic, crazy event of innocent lives taken, I believe God weeps. I believe it. Jesus wept. So the Jews said, see how he loved him. But some of them said, couldn't not he who opens the eyes of the blind man also have kept this man from dying? Man, it sounds like we're right in the pages of what we see around us. But yet God lets and he allows humanity to be humanity and to do and be as they will. I know that's a hard pill to swallow. That's a very hard pill to swallow, but it's true. But today we weep with those who mourn. We mourn with them, and yet we pray for them. But it doesn't just stop with prayer. We try to do what we can to help to heal the human brokenness in humanity. We have to think about what leads someone to a place of committing such horrific acts of violence on innocent lives. I think that we should always be people that study humanity, that we look at things through also through the lens of the word of the Lord to get an understanding and how we can be a part of the healing in seeing what we see in this world today. Youth who are troubled, youth who are tormented, youth who have been despised, rejected, hated, or whatever else they've been through. I think that as a society that we should always walk with a sensitivity to be sensitive to what is around us, while at the same time understanding that we are ministers of the Lord, that we bring life, we bring the light, we bring love, we bring compassion, we bring understanding, we bring something to the table to do what we can. What a powerful thing it was when, when I read about the one teacher that, you know, that got killed there, and then her husband had a heart attack, and they left kids behind. And the response from the humanity, they were just trying to raise $10,000, and I think it's already heading to $2 million almost, or a million plus dollars already. Why is that? That's because people are moved and they feel it and they're responding to it. And shame on Christians that all they want to do is, well, just throw a broad paint brush and just pray. Yes, there is a time to pray. I'm not saying there isn't. But there's a time to move. There's a time to act. There's a time to move in what God is putting in our hearts to do. And not just become so spiritually minded that, you know, that we lose touch. We lose touch of reality. 1 Thessalonians 4:13 says that a word to remind us. He says to us, we do not want you to be uninformed, brothers, about those who are asleep, talking about death, that you may not grieve as others do with no hope. Just simply saying that, you know what, we always need to look beyond that and bring that hope. Yes, we are deeply affected by death, but there's a hope. There's something beyond death. Jesus showed us that there's more beyond death. He conquered death. He rose from among the dead, as some translators put it, that Jesus rose from among the dead. And he came. Romans chapter 12, verses 15, and when you get a chance, just read it, but he begins to encourage us to rejoice with those who rejoice. Weep with those who weep. Man, we rejoice. We rejoice, brother. We celebrate. We rejoice with you, man, when, man, you're overcoming. You're standing up. God is moving in a powerful way. We rejoice with you. But we also weep with you. We're broken with you. Ecclesiastes chapter 3 reminds us that to everything there is a season, to every purpose, and a time, to every purpose under the sun, a time to be born and a time to die. And he goes on to tell us even in verse 4, a time to weep and a time to laugh. A time to mourn and a time to dance. Amen. Amen. Praise God. We're going to pray right now. I want to close up reading a couple of these. And I know Rosemary's going to read some. And I have these all set up here. I don't know. Hon, are you going to read some? Annette's going to read some. And also, you guys, as we begin to read this, we're praying for Irma. We're praying for you, Irma, who lost her husband. You know, and I think this falls in line with the weeping and the mourning and celebrating too. And yet we're celebrating your mom's birthday today, Rosemary. So, but today, one of the ones I want to remember is the two teachers, Eva Mirles. I can't read the name, but if I mess up names, I'm sorry. But an educator for 17 years who taught fourth graders at the school. In a heartwarming tribute on her page, her daughter was praising her mom for her heroism and talked about how outgoing and funny she was. Today we're also remembering Irma Garcia. Irma Garcia with her, and I have a picture here with her and her children. She was also a fourth grade teacher who loved to cook and fish and teach youngsters how to read. And her son, one of her sons, said that she had just won the professional honors as a teacher of the year. And then And I'm going to just read one more here. Nevea Bravo, 10 years old. Nevea, she had just celebrated her 10th birthday in January. But they said that she always put a smile on everyone's face. And Rosemary's going to come up and do the next three here, or the next two.
It's Ellie Garcia. She was 9 years old. Ellie Garcia loved her family. The second oldest of five girls and a fourth grader was always around her sisters. Ellie's father is a DJ, and the girl was constantly singing and dancing with her siblings to the cumbias. Her great aunt, Saria Ardimendez, described Ellie as spontaneous, saying that the girl would break into songs and dance at the family's frequent gatherings. She didn't really care who were, Ardimendez said. If you showed her you cared for her, she was very loving to you. Tess Mata, 10 years old. In December, at the restaurant in San Marcos, Texas, Tess Mata was saving up her purple bedroom in Uvalde, boast, a jar full of cash, which she was hoping to use for the family's vacation to Disney World in Florida. She loved her family and spent as many milestone moments with them as possible. Like her 10th birthday celebration in February at the San Antonio Shopping Center, or at the college ring ceremony for her older sister's face last year in Texas State University in San Marcos. Her favorite team, easy, the Houston Astros. Near that jar of cash in her bedroom hangs a poster of Astros second baseman Jose Altuve. Every time he came up to bat, she would scream and yell for him, said Tess's mother. Alexandria Lexi Rubio, 10 years old. Lexi Rubio, 10, was a standout student and athlete who played basketball, softball, according to those who knew her. Like Ellie Garcia, she was a member of the Spurs, a girls' basketball team that won the local championship in March, the coach wife said. On Tuesday, her parents came to Robb Elementary to see her receive a certificate for making the honor roll, as well as Good Citizens Award, her mother, Kimberly Rubio, wrote in Facebook post.
Annette's going to come and read a couple more. You know, the reason that I want you to hear these, and maybe you already have, is because the humanity side of it, where, you know, it's just not a news thing, but, you know, that we really connect with the families and pray for them. Amen?
Which one? You're reading here. Jacqueline Casadas, 9 years old. She was full of life. She touched a lot of people, Casares said, describing his daughter as his little firecracker. Jacqueline recently celebrated her first communion, Casares said. Through COVID, through the death of a family member about a year ago, she brought us together in something beautiful, Casares said. It comforts me a little bit to think that she would be the one to help her friends in need at the school, he added. Jalela Nicole Sigurio, 10 years old. Jalela is frozen in time, looking at the camera with a hand on her hip and a pink layer around her neck. She is wearing a cheerleading uniform, the initials for Uvalde's team emblazed on her chest in white and silver. Jace Levanos, 10 years old. An interview with his grandfather gave to USA Now. Carmelo Kudo said his grandson lived with him and would make him a pot of coffee each morning. He was our baby, Kudo said. Miranda Mathis, 11 years old. Miranda was fun and spunky. The 11-year-old was also very smart, she said. She had manners. Reese wrote in a message she was a bright girl. Miranda's best friend was her brother Reese, adding that the boy who was also at the school when gunfire broke out in his sister's class. Our condolences.
Thank you. Joshua is going to come and read a couple more. And then we're going to pray.
Amary Jo Garza. Amary Jo Garza was an honor roll student, a proud big sister, an all-around good kid who brushed her teeth without a fuss and listened to her mother and teachers, family said. Amary was a cautious child, her father said. She was afraid of strangers and didn't like being left alone, even if it was only for a moment. Well, Garza stepped out of her car to fill up with gas. She would lock the door, he said. Amiri tried to call for help. Garza, a first responder who arrived at the scene on Tuesday to render emergency medical aid to those inside the school. She was treating a little girl covered in blood when the child told him her friend had been killed, just as she called 911. She was very hysterical, saying they shot her best friend. Her best friend wasn't breathing, and she was just trying to call the cops, Garza said through broken sobs. McKenna Lee Elrod, 10 years old. Loved to dance and sing and made friends everywhere she went. She was beautiful, funny, smart, and amazing. Layla Salazar, 10. Yesterday, we lost our heart, our whole world. She won 6 races at the school's field day. Layla would listen to Sweet Child of Mine by Guns N' Roses on the way to school in the mornings. Salazar said the song is now the only thing that is bringing him peace. Maddie Rodriguez, 10. Maddie had a beautiful smile and was kind to others, her cousin wrote on Facebook. She was her mommy's only girl. She was her mom's best friend. She was the light of her life. She was beyond smart. Her dream was to attend Texas A&M University and become a marine biologist. Annabelle Rodriguez, 10 years old. Outgoing and loved being the center of attention. She was my little diva. Elihana Cruz Torres, 10 years old. Played on a softball team and wondered if she would become an all-star and didn't want the season to end. She was excited, the aunt said, about whether she would land on the all-star roster. What if I make it? I'm going to be so nervous, Eliana said, according to the aunt's recollections.
Hello, my name is Daniel Pacheco. I'm not from town here. I'm from San Diego, and I've just want to read this name. Rogelio Torres, 10. Rogelio was a very smart and loving child. Alicia Ramirez, 10. Peace out, single digits. I'm 10. Alicia was very kind. Oh, yeah, her shirt has a peace sign, and it says single digits. I'm 10. That must have been her birthday shirt. Alita was very kind, very caring. She loved art. She also loved to play soccer. She was a very talented little girl. Alita's grandmother, Rosa Maria Ramirez, told ABC she loved to draw. She was real sweet, never getting into trouble. Beautiful children.
Thank you. Thank you, man. Did you raise your hand? Come on up, brother. Yeah, Dennis, I'm sorry. If you can read that one.
Xavier Lopez, 10. The Lopez household was teeming with children's laughter and music, and its source, more often than not, was 10-year-old Javier Lopez cracking a joke or dancing cumbia. He was funny, never serious, and his smile. Xavier was so full of life, she said, and a bright light for the family. Never went to shy away from the camera. He would sway his hips, wave his arms, and energetically dance in the house with his brothers. At school, Javier enjoyed sports, soccer and baseball, and had a great interest in art, his favorite subject. Jose Flores, 10. He was a very happy little boy. He loved both his parents and loved to laugh and have fun. Jose had two brothers and a sister, loved going to school. On Tuesday, hours before the shooting, Jose had received an award for making the honor roll. He was very smart, Salazar said. He wasn't a kid who would look for trouble.
That's it. Thank you.
That's it.
Thank you, Dennis. It's tough, huh? Very tough. I want to read, if somebody would like to read one last one. Anybody here would like to read the very last one here? Come on up, Sylvia. Good to see you here today, Sylvia. We welcome you, sis. She's been our friend for years. I think from the projects, no?
Probably so. And this is how pronounced.
Yeah.
Ulysses.
And just hold the mic up close to you.
How do you pronounce this?
Elias.
Elias Garcia, 10. Elias Garcia was getting ready for long days of football, swimming, video games, and whatever other fun the summer might offer after he finished fourth grade. He was the sweetest, the kindest child. His aunt, Leticia Garcia of Grand Prairie, Texas, said in a telephone interview, very polite, loved Jesus. He loved, absolutely loved his parents. Grandfather Manny Renfor told the Associated Press that Elias had been, had last visited him in San Antonio, Texas during spring break, and he taught his grandson football passes, patterns. Renfer and Elias said Elias was the sweetest little boy that I've ever known. I'm not just saying that because he was my grandkid, he said.
Thank you so much. Wow, heavy duty, isn't it? I'm going to ask us to stretch our hands toward heaven and lift them toward heaven. I know it's very tough, you know, when you look at the stories, and I'm sure that, you know, that many of us have been in those places, those times, where we've lost somebody that we deeply cared about and impacted us in such a tremendous way that literally broke us and tore us apart. But today, Father, and just like this little 10-year-old, Lord, that it was noted that he was very polite, that he loved Jesus, and he absolutely loved his parents. Father, we know that each and every one of these kids, Father, innocent little ones, pure of heart. And Father, we know that, Lord, that if anybody were to offend, according to the scripture, any one of these little ones would cause them to stumble, to fall, and caused them harm, Father, that it were better that a millstone were tied around their neck and cast into the depths of the sea. But Father, we just say that because of, that's how severe this is, Lord, when innocence is taken. And so today, Father, we pray for all the families impacted, affected, Lord, by this horrible, horrific act of violence, Father. Lord, demonic in nature, and Father, of course, very confusing in humanity's mind. But Father, today we just pray the comfort of the Holy Spirit upon these families, upon this nation, upon this country, upon this world, that Father, throughout the world, that Father, wherever little ones are suffering, and little ones are suffering this kind of harm, we pray, Father, for the comfort of the Holy Spirit. And Lord, not only the comfort, but Lord, just the moving, acting, compassionate acts of kindness, Lord, that bring healing, that bring strength, that bring comfort. And Lord, we just pray, Lord, for them. And Father, we thank you, Lord, that as they're going through this, that Lord, that you are with them and that you are in our midst. And that Father, that in your own unique, powerful way, that you are able to heal and able to comfort and able to strengthen them, we pray. Lord, there's going to be a lot of void and emptiness, Lord. We just pray that you fill those spaces in your own unique way. We ask it now in the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit. In Jesus' mighty name we pray. And everyone said amen. Amen. I don't know if, you know, we need to offer another prayer, but I encourage you throughout the week, keep praying for them, keep lifting them up, and man, such a horrible thing, horrible. So just keep praying for them, you guys, and wish them well. Be good, be kind, amen. We don't need no political warfares and religious warfares and all that kind of stuff. Put it aside. Squash it in the name of Jesus. Amen. Let's stand up. I want to bless you in the name of the Lord. Thank you all for coming today. Really appreciative. Thank you for your prayers. Thank you for your support. To continue to support this ministry, of course, you can drop an offering in the back, or you can visit us online at faithcenter.cc. And we just thank you, Father, today. Bless your people. Thank you, Lord. May we be game changers. May we be ministers of life, of healing, of reconciliation. May we bring love, faith, compassion, and hope. We ask it now in the name of your Son, Jesus, we pray. And everyone said, amen.